I'm here tonight to provide a short introduction to the recent work of Jane Seanza, following the way I tried to contextualize it in this book, which is available in printed form in English and Slovenian through lulu.com or Amazon soon. But it's also available as a free download book, both in Slovenian and English. So if you don't want to buy it, you can always download the PDF and have a look to it. Actually, I'm a very bad speaker, so probably at the end of this introduction, you won't believe that I wrote the book, but you will you will think that I just read it some minutes before coming here. But if you get some good points from my introduction, I invite you to download at least the book, because the ideas that I will try to summarize tonight are expressed much more better in the book. So I guess everybody here knows who is Jane Seanza, and I guess everybody in this room knows that around 2007 three artists from Slovenia changed their name to Jane Seanza. So probably you don't need any further contextualization about this event. But I have to take it as my starting point, because in order to understand the work of Jane Seanza, I had to make a step back and reconsider what I myself thought for a long time. In order to understand the recent developments in the work of Jane Seanza, I think it's important to understand what summarized the year, that this name change, this event in their life, is not an artwork, is not an art gesture of any kind, is not a performance, but it's just a live event, an event in their life that had consequences on their life, and also on their work. Actually, one of the things that happened and that we will try to understand better later is that many things that can be considered artworks have been generated by other people, institutions, companies, and so on, as an act of response to this life event. But the event itself is not a performance. You may wonder why this statement is so important for me. I think there are two main reasons. Of course, when you do something as an artist, whatever is it, and either you explain your reasons or not, you are expected to make a point, to say something, to create meaning. So if we consider this event, the name change, an artwork, we should suppose that this event has a meaning, and the meaning may change according to our interpretation, but is only one. Instead, when we make choices in our life, we are not always expected to provide a meaning for them. Actually, even if we are very serious people, we can take decisions also for very stupid reasons, no? And we are allowed to do it because it's our life and it's the way it goes. So One thing that happens if we consider this name change an art project is that everything that comes after the event can be allowed to have just one interpretation, the interpretation that we gave to the event, and everything that is done should be interpreted as documentation of the main project, no? And of course, we can have an understanding of these following works, for example, the identity cards and the credit cards that are on show in this exhibition. But this understanding will be very limited to the fact that they are documenting an art performance, this name change, that was probably done for political reasons, because the name that they picked out was the name of the former prime minister in Slovenia, and a very controversial figure, and so on. And we can't escape from here. And this is actually very dangerous for the work itself, because it's not allowed to have any other meaning. So I choose out of the former work of Janez Jans this image, because I think this point becomes quite clear here, no? You have three paintings. These paintings have been commissioned to a professional painter who was asked to reproduce them manually the signatures of the three Janez Jans after the name change. Of course, these paintings document an event in their life, the name change, but it will be hard to understand them. There is also another level that may be useful to understand them, because the three paintings have then later been signed by each Janez Jans using the different identities that they have, and that in some cases are still legally valid. For example, in the case of Janez Jans, Davide Grassi, he already has some documents, valid documents with the former name that are valid at least in Italy. So in this work there is much more than just documenting a performance with a political meaning, and we can't understand this much more if we consider the name change the main artwork that produced all of the following. Okay, this slide introduces a short reflection about what's called art documentation, or what actually the German art critic and theoretician Boris Groys called art documentation. I used this example from the work of Vanessa Beecroft because I think it's a good example of one potential declination of art documentation. We have a performance. This image has been taken from an auction house website, so the video is also on sale, and this video, which has a strong economic value and so is recognized somehow as an artwork, is an artwork that documents another artwork, the performance VB45 that happened in Vienna in 2011. So here we can see the process of creation of artifacts that document another artwork, in this case a performance, and perpetuate its presence in the media and in the museum and in the art market and so on. I think we should try to read this quotation from Art Power, because it's very meaningful from what we are going to say. Boris Groys in 2008 wrote, "For those who devoted themselves to the production of art documentation rather than artworks, art is identical to life, because life is essentially a pure activity that has no end result. Art documentation marks the attempt to use artistic media within art spaces to refer to art, to life itself, that is, to a pure activity, a pure practice, to an artistic life, as it were, without presenting it directly. Art becomes a life form, whereas the artwork becomes non-art, a mere documentation of this life form. One could also say that art becomes biopolitical, because it begins to use artistic means to produce and document life as a pure activity. Indeed, art documentation as an art form could only develop under the conditions of today's biopolitical age, in which life itself has become the object of technical and artistic intervention." Of course, this quotation provides really a good context for the work of the Jansiansa, and Jansiansa, especially with the last sentence that says, "in which life itself has become the object of technical and artistic intervention." In this case, we have an intervention in life that produce further material that not only documents it, but adds new layers, new elements that are worth considering. Actually, this quotation also extends the idea of art documentation to something that is much more than this. For Boris Groys, actually, art documentation is not just performance documentation, but can be more understood as the main way in which art manifests itself today. These are three works by Tracy Emin. This is the documentation of a performance that is sold as an autonomous and presented as an autonomous work. This is an installation. It's called My Bed, and I think it doesn't require any other explanation. And this is a painting that is part of a bigger installation made of 97 works. All of the of these three works can be understood in Boris Groys terms as art documentation, not just the documentation of the performance, but also the bed, which is not valuable as an artifact, but it's valuable just because it refers to the artistic life of Tracy Emin. And the same thing can be said for the painting, which again is not an autonomous work like a painting from the Renaissance that is valuable in itself, but just because it is a manifestation of something immaterial, which is actually the art of Tracy Emin. So, of course, for Boris Groys, the main way in which art documentation takes place in the institution and on the market is the art installation, which is the form of contemporary art par excellence, no? And in his text, he goes on reflecting on this and saying that While on the one side the installation is not an artwork because it's presenting something that is not in the artifacts but it's something in material, something outside. At the same time, in order to be accepted as a museum object, it has to be turned into an artwork and into an artifact. And this is the main meaning of the form of installations according to Boris Groys. The function of the installation is that to turn a series of artifacts that are not art in themselves into an art object that can be presented legitimately in a museum. Okay, with this background, maybe we can understand better what's at stake for me in this and other works by Janez Jansa. I have another quotation and I will read it. The dominant medium of modern biopolitics is thus bureaucratic and technological documentation, which includes planning, decrees, fact-finding reports, statistical inquiries, and project plans. It is no coincidence that art also uses the same medium of documentation when it wants to refer to itself as life. Again, this is another really strong point. Documentation is something that refers to life. Also, in our daily life, we exhibit an ID card because we want to prove that we exist as a living being and we have an identity, and the identity is the one certified by the ID card. So, if, according to Groys, if you want to show that the artwork we are going to show is actually something alive, is not something that reliquary from the past, documentation is a really good medium because in daily life it always refers to life. The other reason why I choose this quote is that even if it doesn't mention ID cards, it doesn't mention credit cards and so on, it describes perfectly the work that we are discussing. But with a limitation, in my opinion. And again, the limitation is that this concept of art documentation, allows you to understand these works as a simple proof of something that is happened. And the artistic quality of these artifacts is only connected to the fact that they are documenting this something else. While I think that in these works there is something else at stake. For example, look at these two pictures. This is the passport of one of the Janez Jansa, and it was sold at an auction. I don't remember when, I think 2011? 10, okay, 2010. When it was sold, the buyer had to accept some kind of agreement that stated that even if he was the owner of the document, because he bought it, he had to leave it in the hands of the artist until it was a valid document, because otherwise the artist himself would lose any possibilities to show, to travel, to show it to persons, to officials when they ask to prove your identity and so on. Of course, accepting this agreement, he also accepted that this artwork that he bought may be damaged during the time in which it is in the hands of the artist, because of course you don't go around with a safe proof thing in order to preserve it as an artifact. You just have to have it in your pocket and to show it when upon request. A passport is also validated when you go to an airport and you go to another country. So it becomes something different from what the buyer bought in the first place. I'm telling you this because this is a good example to show how this artifacts keep being two things at the same time. No, they are still valid documents, and these valid documents have a value in themselves in our daily life, and they are also artwork, at least because they were certified as such by the museums that showed them, by the curator that provided an opinion about this work to the auction house in order to sell it, by the auction house itself who sold it. There are some events in the life of this document that turned it into an artwork and certified it as such, but the document itself is still a valid document. And this identity, this the primary identity of the document, is still the stronger one, is still the one that can affect the life of the document as an object. And this produces quite a clash between the identity of the two institutions, the government and the museum that want to take care of this document. While at the same time will be impossible without the active collaborations of these institutions, because without a museum wanting to show this document as an artwork, it won't be an artwork. Without an auction house and without a buyer, it would be an artifact that can be also recognized as an artwork. So there are at least these two points that make these documents stronger than the notion of art documentation that is provided by Boris Groys. The first element is that they are not produced by the artist themselves, they are not handmade by them, but they are produced by the institutions in response to what they made. And the second point is that they are ambiguous artifacts that share two different identities at the same time: the identity of legal and valid document and the identity of artwork. On this, I disagree a little bit with the artists themselves, who at some point say that the artistry of these artworks is connected to their very ambiguity that will be lost, of course, when the document is not a legal document, a legally valid document anymore. Because I think that some way, even if this, even when this document will expire, It will still be perceived as the emanation of an institutional power that is stronger than the museum, than the one provided by the museum institution. And so if even if we notice on the document that it's not a legally valid document anymore, in some way it will be still outrageous to see a formerly valid document on show in a museum. And I think this is an important point also for credit cards, because the work that they are doing with credit cards has really a very short term expiration date. Why? Because when they order a new credit card connected to the same account, and even if the credit card is displaying that it will be valid until 2017, this artifact will lose its validity automatically, no? It's not valid anymore as a credit card. You can't use it to take your money, because you have a new credit card with a new number registered on the same account. So this one, if we accept that the artistry of this object is connected to its ambiguous nature and its validity, is just a document of something happened in the past that has lost this ambiguity. At the same time, however, I think that there is so much power in this and in this and in this, in all the elements that are not part of the artist intervention, but are part of the nature of this artifact. There is so much power in it, so much, we have so much fascination for the importance of banks and credit card systems like MasterCard accept this object as a simple documentation of something of the past. Again, there is this famous slogan of MasterCard that says there are things that you can't do, for all the rest you have MasterCard. No, I don't think it's a good translation, but I have it somewhere in the book. But this slogan is a good summary of the godlike nature of this artifact as a functional artifact. And so even if this function is lost, it will haunt some way the artifact, at least for a long time, for some years. I think I ran out of time. I have still some things to present you, but I also don't want to steal you the pleasure, if it's a pleasure, to download and read the book. Maybe we can say something about this last series of credit cards. I didn't mention it, but I guess you got it from these images. What they are doing with the credit cards is not just registering multiple credit cards under the name of Janez Jansa, but is also adding a personalized, a custom image on the surface. And this is another interesting point of intervention that could not completely be explained if we just think about them as a documentation. of the name change main event. Because what happens on this tiny surface when they pick out a former artwork by themselves, or when they shoot a picture with the idea, with the project to place it on the credit card, is actually an interesting clash between all the elements that you have on the credit card, the functional elements, the microchip, the logos of the credit card and the bank and so on, and the image that they put on it. For example, this series, I Love Germany, in which basically it's a series of photos in which the artists are wearing this t-shirt, I Heart Germany, I Love Germany, in front of different situations that may be politically or economically connotated. These images, of course, are very simple, but at the same time very meaningful in themselves. But the kind of reflection, the kind of inquiry that they put forward about the importance of economics in today's life and today's politics, of course, is enforced by the idea, by the interaction of this image with the other images on the surface of the credit card. And also by the idea that they were made in collaboration with the companies that issue credit cards. Because of course their intervention is subversive in some way, but in the same time it seems to be kind of accepted by the banks and the big companies like MasterCard as a way to promote their services, for example, their service of customization of credit cards. And so there is this kind of dialogue with the institutions that they themselves call institutional complicity, that is a step forward in a way in criticism of the institution, no? Because today it's quite impossible to criticize institutions, be they art institutions or economic, legal institutions, how can I say, in a very frontal and direct way. It's impossible to escape them and act against them in a way. So what artists and also activists and hackers in other situations are trying to do, as Tatiana Bazzichelli points out in this other book that may be worth reading, Network Disruption, is that the dialogue between these entities is becoming more layered, more intertwined between each other. And this is not a failure of activism, but actually the only way in which you can try to intervene and make a point in the current situation. I don't know if you have questions, of course you can do them. I think I've talked for a long time, so maybe you are a little bit bored and tired. Maybe before questions I just point you the website where you can download or buy this book, this and other books. Actually, I have here some that you can have a look to. In this case, I'm in the strange situation to be both the editor and the publisher of the book, because Link Editions is a publishing initiative that I started in Italy with other partners that are working with me in this no-profit institution called Link Center. And the Link Editions publishes these books using the print-on-demand solution. And so basically they are only available online. You won't find them in stores, but you will find them in online stores and also in the bigger bookstore ever, which is Amazon, of course. That's it. Thank you very much for your patience.